20 minutes, I will show you when 45 minutes are ready.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm sorry for those of you that were present here on Wednesday, because I'm going to repeat some of the points I already mentioned, but at least you will not forget positive list after that. And also now it's in my Italian English, so it's much funnier. Okay, the first thing I'm going to repeat is that Eurogroup for Animals is a federation of 60 member organizations in 24 EU member states and beyond, because we have members also in the United States and Australia. And it has been mentioned several times today, but also yesterday, that the exotic pet trade is one of the main pathways of introduction of invasive animal species. And this is because exotic pets have very special needs. They are difficult to keep in captivity, and then they may escape, or they may be intentionally released by the owners when they become tired of, or they are not willing anymore to provide for these special needs, or just because the lifespan of the animals is much more than initially thought when they bought the animal. So at EU level, let's say that beside the few species that are traded as pets and that are covered by the CITES convention, there's this new regulation since 2014 on invasive alien species, which include what we call a negative list, so a list of the species that are forbidden, which the trade, the breeding, the keeping is prohibited, with few exceptions. And the problem with this kind of list, as everybody is now seeing, is that the updating process is very low, and complicated. So the problem also when it is about exotic pets is that the trade on exotic pets is very dynamic. And yesterday it has been stated in one of the presentations that in Italy you are succeeding to eradicate a gray squirrel, but there are already new species of squirrel that are appearing. So it's continuously, once one species is forbidden, the traders put in the trade a new species to replace it. And also there are fashions for some species that appear regularly. So a negative list is always late compared to the trade, and this is the problem. So species are prohibited only once there's already a problem in place and it becomes very difficult or impossible to solve the problem. Instead, positive lists is what we are promoting with a campaign since 2013. It's the opposite approach. Let's say there's a list of species that are allowed, and all the rest is prohibited. So it's much more transparent, much more clear, much more preventive in nature, because only those species that are completely safe, that have been evaluated to be safe for the health, for the health of people, for the health of other animals, because pets can also transfer disease to domesticated animals, also farmed animals, with important economic loss. Also species for which the welfare can be guaranteed, reasonably guaranteed, let's say, in captivity by the average owner, are included in the list, and a species that don't risk to be invasive, or species that are not in danger of extinction in the country of origin, so don't put the conservation of the species at risk in their country of origin. Only those species are included in this kind of list. And the positive list is not something new, but in reality they already exist for all the products we usually, every day, we use in our everyday life. For example, if you compare these toys, turtle toys, It has been tested to not be dangerous for the children that play with it and for the environment. And if you compare with a turtle, which is a living being, so also the welfare should be normally taken in consideration, nothing of that exists. They can, of course, bite. There are some turtles that are particularly aggressive. They can scratch, they can transfer disease like salmonellosis to people. And they can be very invasive, but there's no control in this sense. Everything is possible, everything can be put in the market without any previous screening. And this is very special. It only exists for pet trade, because for any other kind of product, only those products that are safe for the environment, for the health, are put in the trade. Now, if we look at the legislation in place on exotic pet in member states in Europe, when we started our campaign in 2013, this was the situation with most of the countries with a negative list, a few countries with a positive list under consideration, and a few countries with a positive list in a low proposal, and then only Belgium already since 2001 with a positive list in the legislation already. And today this is the situation. So you can see that the positive list system is spreading with more and more countries that are considering to adopt this or have already adopted. At the moment there are Belgium, Netherlands, Norway, Malta that already have in place positive lists, either for mammals or reptiles or both of them. So the system is going to have a lot of success and is adopted in many member states. And we recently organized an event at the European Parliament to promote this system. And the Commissioner for Environment, Carmen Novella, sent us a video message for the day, stating that positive lists are perfectly legitimate legislation that member states can adopt to prevent the introduction of new invasive alien species in their country. So it's perfectly fine for the EU institutions. Now let's see two examples of this legislation, because there are differences anyway between member states on how the legislation has been adopted and implemented. So in Belgium, as I said, this was the first country in Europe to adopt a positive list, a very innovative system in Europe. And the species, it's a positive list only for mammals. And the species are included in the list after being evaluated according to five objective criteria. The first one is that the species should be easy to keep and capable of being given shelter with respect of the fundamental animal needs. It should be not pose particular danger to human health, not threat to local fauna if escapes, or not possibility to become an invasive alien species. Bibliographic data should exist on the keeping of the species. Good bibliographic data, sound bibliographic data, so peer-reviewed papers, not just articles in a newspaper, of course. And in case of conflict, because for many species it's impossible to find this information or the data are insufficient, the benefit of the doubt goes to the animals. So it means that the species is simply not included in the list. So those species that have been included in the list are those that have been completely, according to all these criteria, has been assessed to be completely safe. There are derogations, of course, for zoological gardens, circuses, laboratories, and private persons. Because, as I said, the positive list, it has been drafted for the average owner, the average people without any specific knowledge that want to buy a pet in a pet shop. But if there are persons that are specialized and that can demonstrate they have the knowledge to keep other species that are not in the list, they can apply for a permit, for a license, And if the permit is the request of permit is evaluated, and if it is okay, they will receive a permit, a license for the species. And also there's an exemption for the animals that were already in possession of private people before the adoption of the positive list. So of course these animals were not requested to be euthanized or delivered to rescue center, but people that can demonstrate that they had the animal before the adoption of the legislation, they were allowed to keep it. Now, more in detail, in 2001 the first list has been adopted with 42 mammal species on that, with this possibility for licensing specialized people. And evaluation was made on scientific basis by biologists and then a committee representing all stakeholders, so the traders and all kind of people involved in the trade, evaluated the list. In 2006, the traders from Belgium and the Netherlands challenged the legislation, the European Court of Justice, on the basis that this was not respecting the requirement of the treaties, the EU treaties, and particularly those that stated that quantitative restriction on imports and all measures having equivalent effect should be prohibited between member states. And also, they were saying that positive list is not a proportionate to the objective pursued, because according to the treaties, only measures that are proportionate to the objective can be allowed, only this kind of restriction. So the European Court of Justice in 2008 decided with those it's called the Endible ruling, that a restriction may be justified for the protection of the environment and animal welfare is a legitimate objective in the public interest, so the Belgian list was completely legitimate. However, it was requested to include in the legislation objective non-discriminatory criteria to assess the species, and this was not in the first list, a procedure for adding new species to the list. So in 2009, a new royal decree has been adopted, exactly with the same list of 42 mammal species that were in the previous list, but with this addition that new species can be added if it can be demonstrated that they are safe according to the criteria of the positive list. And this is a part of the list, because otherwise it was not readable, but of course I have the full list I can send to you if you are interested. So it's a list about all mammal pets, it's not about only exotic, but it's a list of the mammal pets that are allowed to be kept by private people. The Netherlands adopted a little bit different approach. I think it's quite interesting because the two approaches reflect the difference in the two countries. The difference on the trade, that in Belgium was not very important, while in the Netherlands there's a quite a strong lobby of traders and hobbyists that have exotic pets. So they had to adopt a more careful and scientific approach. So they asked in 2014 to the Wageningen University to identify a methodology, an objective and scientific methodology to assess the species to be included in the list. In 2015, the Netherlands adopted the ministerial decree describing the positive list system and stating that a positive list, so a list of the species, was under development and will be added to the legislation soon. Again, a positive list for mammals first and secondly for reptiles. In 2017, the minister developed a first draft of the list, and this was discussed in a committee and adopted. But then in 2017, the traders made a lawsuit stating, not complaining about the positive list concept, because this is, according to the European Court of Justice now, this is not possible anymore to complain about that, But they were claiming that the committee evaluating the list was not, the composition of the committee was not transparent and not representing all the stakeholders involved. So in December 2018, the Netherlands created a new committee and they are now re-evaluating the list that has been drafted by the Wageningen University. The interesting, it's a long process, much more complicated than the one in Belgium, but the good thing is that when they will finally publish this list, which we know at the moment is more or less the same number of animals than the Belgian one, the Wageningen University will publish their methodology in a peer-reviewed paper. So this will be available even for other countries that want to just copy and paste the system. They don't have to develop again criteria and method for the assessment of the species. So we hope that before 2019 this will be published. So the conclusions are that yes, the system works because the Belgium experience showed that the positive list is well respected. We analyzed the number of confiscated confiscation cases in the last years, and we found it is a very low number. The Belgian government say that they are very satisfied with the implementation enforcement of the legislation. It's following a scientific and objective approach. It is very important, of course, to avoid problem and challenging legal challenging. They should include a procedure to add species because this is what the European Court of Justice decided. There should be this possibility always. No legal objections are possible anymore because of the decision of the European Court of Justice, so positive lists are a legitimate method to restrict the trade on exotic pets. Enforcement is easy because it's a list of few species that is very, which is very easy not only for the people that has to respect, but also for the enforcer. So they don't have to be able to recognize thousands and thousands of species, but just the one that are in the list, since the only these one are legally traded. Also, in the drafting a list, country's peculiarity should be taken in consideration because now, for example, we have Lithuania and Luxembourg that are adopting the Belgian system, so they will just more or less copy and paste the Belgian list because they don't have a huge trade in their countries, they don't expect a big opposition in their countries. Others are more careful because they know there's quite important trade, and Finland, for example, is now finalizing, will be adopted by the end of 2018, the legislation with a positive list for mammals. But again, the list will be developed later on, maybe using the criteria developed by the Netherlands. So this is depending on the situation of the countries, and this should be taken in consideration. So yes, prevention is better than cure, as it has been stated today also. So we encourage your other countries to use this system. And of course, I'm fully available to provide more information and more documentation on this kind of legislation. Thank you for your time. Yes, so in Belgium they are developing, they already developed the first list for reptiles, so this will be available very soon. And in Norway, they also have a list for reptiles, and the Netherlands is planning to develop a list for reptiles as soon as they finish with the mammals list. The interesting thing is that in Belgium, for the reptile list, they added a criteria that was not present in their list for mammals, which is the one that the species should be not wild caught. So only captive bred species are included in the list, and those that are not in danger of extinction in their country of origin, because it's the problem with reptiles that is quite serious. So there are, for the moment, the other one that are under development are reptiles. And concerning the online trade, when we made this review on the enforcement of the positive list in Belgium, we analyzed also the advertisement online to see if there was an important illegal trade online. And we found out that there was an average of 6 legal advertisements per month, so still not a huge number compared to other countries without this kind of legislation. And in Belgium, Belgium has adopted also the prohibition to publish advertisement for pets in online. So they are struggling to have the respect of this ban. But let's say that they are trying to control and to check what is happening also online. Of course, this is the main challenge, because exotic pet trade is mainly online at the moment, so it's something that should be taken in consideration. And so a prohibition also to publish online advertisement, at least in the country with the positive list, should also be taken into consideration to complete.
Compliments for the communication. It's a very positive approach, in my opinion, to take care of to do something before the problem spreads around. As a botanist, I'm also very much worried about the internet possibility to buy plants, especially for aqualia, because the problem is that you can forbid it in a country, but the internet is everywhere, so the proposal can come in your own language, but perhaps it comes from another area of the world, so it's very difficult to respect laws, even if they exist. So I ask you, but I don't know if you have an answer, if there is any possibility to take care of this aspect.
Let's say that I think that what also the Belgian government acknowledged that they have to improve their control on the trade online, because at the moment this is also quite new for them, so they have to adapt to this change, and they are still a bit late. But yes, this should become a routine, the control also of the advertisement, the Facebook groups selling animals or plants, in case, to try to control what is happening online. So of course it's challenging, but I think that's much more than is presently can be done in the future, if it is a routine system of control that is put in place. And these are something that more and more countries are considering to adopt.
Yeah, just regarding the internet commerce, we had a few meetings in the last months. I was chairing a meeting at the WCO, the World Customs Organization, that is working on an assessment on the e-commerce. Also the FAO is working on this issue. The message they gave us is that it's doable, it's possible to address e-commerce. Most platforms like eBay, Alibaba, this big platform, are keen to sign MOUs, so memorandum of understanding, but they need clear lists. They need countries to have clear regulations and clear lists. If countries don't have regulations, they cannot do anything. So it's not easy, of course, but I think that positive lists or clear lists, like in the European system, is a crucially important basis for improving work. And in general, we have seen a more positive attitude than I thought in terms of addressing the issue also from the platform. Of course, there is the risk of illegal movements, but you know, already having a common line of work with the major dealers, eBay, Amazon, Alibaba, and so on, would be, of course, a huge progress. So working on lists is a good basis, I think.
Yeah, just to add that, yes, we had this conversation with some online website as well, and with platform, with eBay, for instance. And they are also willing to voluntarily, even if it is not yet in the legislation, to voluntarily adopt positive lists they are considering. And the Gumtrees, which is the UK branch, let's say, of eBay, has now decided to adopt a positive list for the pets that they will sell online. So they are, yes, that's also a possible approach on voluntary basis, waiting for a legislation. Of course, when there's a legislation, it's much easier. But someone is considering it.
Okay, Tim, you still have your question for Genovese. We have 1 minute
left. Thank you. It relates a bit to this positive list story. I was wondering, we are taking in Europe now, with the new regulation, clearly a blacklist approach in terms of IS policy. And in fact, when you look at all the data worldwide, the only island that is really able to curb the trend is New Zealand, where they have a whitelist approach. We are a peninsula in Europe, not an island, so it's a completely different story. But I was wondering, what's your opinion on where we go with this blacklist, and why have we chosen a blacklist approach and not a whitelist approach? And is there any prospect that, for instance, there will be a dedicated funding mechanism? I know there is and they are very important tools. But there is no dedicated funding or agency at European level implementing this new biosecurity thing for biodiversity, whereas for plant health and animal health, there is such an agency and it's a very powerful tool. Is there any prospect that the European Commission would do such thing?
I've been advocating for longer for using whitelist approach, that is a positivist approach, but it was considered impossible not to comply with WTO. The case of Europe decided that it was not possible by but again, in my talk, I mentioned that Norway, for example, that is part of our geographic region, has adopted the whitelist approach. So if the number of countries, for example, I'm trying to organize a sedimental substrate technical meeting of the CDB invited the Commission, Iceland, Norway, Mexico, to see if in the future this could be a positive direction. And of course we could use it in our national lists, because national lists are formally included in the regulation as a possibility. They are designed as a blacklist approach, but I don't see a problem if countries want to use a positive list approach. So if legally this has been found potentially consistent with the free trade legislation, I think it's possible to think of it. It will take time, there are resistances, but I think it's possible. Frankly, I don't share the negative view of the law in terms of the slow process. We are adding new species even too rapidly, I shouldn't say that, but you know, from an emergency point of view, we decided to stop in 1 year just because we are all overloaded by work. So the initial cap of 50 species is already there, and we already have many more species that will probably be added in the future. So I think that even the blacklist approach is an effective. Of course, the possibility is suspected, but I think that it's quite encouraging to see that in these first years, the enforcement is dynamic and countries don't, are not stopping most species to engine. That would be, of course, top topic, the means and a few others. accepting the idea that the listing should be dynamic. Regarding the agency, something like 7 years ago, I did an assessment of the European Environment Agency, and I proposed different options. One was an agency, so I did an assessment of the cost for having an agency or different approaches. There are many oppositions to have new agencies because agencies are incredibly costly. Salaries are very high. Many countries are against an agency. Another option that I proposed, much lower cost, was a panel of experts that could support decision making. And somehow this is the approach that has been used by the Commission with the scientific forum, with the contracts to IUCN for supporting work. It is much less costly. Is it much less effective? Probably yes. We suggested the idea of learning from the health agency in Sweden or from the EFSA agency in Parma. But you know, one table of the EFSA agency costs 1 million euros per year. One table, one risk assessment. So I understand the economic concern. So we went for a less ambitious approach. We are all part of it, and I think it's somehow working.